Hi guys, my name is Anuj Jindal and today we are going to discuss some more MCQs for the upcoming examinations. These MCQs are going to hold importance for the upcoming NABARD examination and the yet to be disclosed or released notifications but the sure examinations of RBI as well as SEBI. These MCQs are related with current affairs of economic and social issues for the month of February 2019. So let us start with the So as you can see here on my left hand side, the MCQs of February 2019 are going to be discussed today. Let us start with the first MCQ. The question says, the Election Commission made certain rules regarding usage of VVPATs. Let me give you the full form of VVPAT. If you also know the full form of VVPAT, please write it down in the comment section below and pause the video before writing it down. The full form is Voter Verifiable Paper Audit Trail, VVPATS. The question is, the Election Commission has made certain rules regarding usage of VVPATs in elections. Identify the incorrect one. So we have to identify the incorrect one rather than identifying the correct one. The first point is, the slip generated in VVPAT is visible to the voter for 7 seconds. I am sure all of you have voted in the recent elections. And therefore, you must be aware about for how many seconds did you see that slip which came out of VVPAT machine. The Election Commission has announced 100% use of VVPAT during elections. And the Election Commission has agreed to demands of various parties and announced 50% use of VVPATs during elections. So these two points, point number 2 and point number 3, are totally opposite to each other or in conflict with each other, because point 2 says 100% use of VVPATs and point 3 says, although framed differently but it says the same thing, 50% use of VVPATs. Point 4 says only 10% of VVPAT slips are to be counted for cross verification of votes casted by voters. There was a strong controversy regarding this. All the political parties other than the BJP were demanding a 25% counting of VVPAT slips, but the Supreme Court and the Election Commission allowed something else. Is that 10%? Please let me know the answers in the comment section below before I tell you the answer and the explanation. The options are A, all are correct, B, 1, 2 and 4 are correct, C, 1, 3 and 4 are correct, D, 1 and 2 are correct and E, 1 and 3 are correct. So which are the incorrect ones? The slip generated in VVPAT is visible to voter for 7 seconds. This certainly is a correct option. The Election Commission has announced 100% use of VVPATs during elections. This also is correct. Yes, the Election Commission has announced 100% use of VVPATs, but not 100% counting of VVPATs after counting is done on the EVM. Therefore, point 3 is incorrect. Only 10% of VVPATs are to be counted for cross verification. The actual number is not 10%, the actual number is 5 seats in a particular constituency. In a particular constituency. Or 5 polling booths to be more accurate. 5 polling booths in a particular constituency. That is almost 0.5% and sometimes even less than 0.5%. So the answer of 10% in the fourth option is incorrect. So the correct options are 1 and 2 only, that is option D. I hope VVPAT is more clear now. Let's come to second question. Consider the following statements regarding National Policy on Electronics. National Policy on Electronics 2019, a very important policy. I'm expecting some kind of questions in either phase 1 of NABARD or phase 2 of NABARD. And identify the incorrect ones. NPE, National Policy on Electronics, was proposed by MeITY, which is Ministry of Electronics and Information Technology. That is correct. NPE 2019 aims to position India as a global hub for ESDM. That is also correct. The policy aims at achieving a turnover of $400 billion by 2025 in ESDM. That is also correct. NPE is focused on domestic production and exports of high-value electronic goods to the world market. That in fact is also correct. So the correct answer is all are correct or none of them is incorrect. Let's have a look at the important features of National Policy on electronics 2019. Number one, it promotes domestic manufacturing and exports in the entire value chain. Providing special package for incentives, for mega projects which are extremely high tech and therefore high value products. That was the fourth point in the above question, and entail huge investments like semiconductor facility display, fabrication, etc. Enhancing the availability of skilled manpower, including reskilling. So this was not available or asked in the question, but this is something that can be asked in the question. You should be aware about this also, that NPE does not only entail or does not only include provisions related to exporting or manufacturing high value goods, but it also includes reskilling or skilling of manpower so that these skilled professionals can contribute towards manufacturing and exports of high value products. Special focus on chip design industry because of monopoly in the world market by Intel in this particular industry. Sovereign patent fund to promote the development and acquisition of IPs, that is intellectual property, in ESDM sector. Sovereign patent fund that is to be created so that intellectual property rights can be enhanced or strengthened in the country, because a weak set of intellectual property rights results in a very weak set of innovation chain in the industry or in the economy. Please provide me with the full form of ESDM. I'm not providing it right now here. Go and have a look at the entire national policy on electronics. You will be able to find the full form of ESDM and provide it in the comment section below. That will help you read more on national policy on electronics as well. Let's come to the third question. The question says, consider the following statements regarding unregulated deposit schemes ordinance 2019 and identify the incorrect one. Now this question holds a lot of importance, and this topic also holds a lot of importance for the RBI and SEBI examination. The reason being that this is directly connected with Indian financial markets. In NABARD as well, because this is an ordinance, therefore, in NABARD, in ESI section, this can also be asked. Let's have a look at the options. We have to find out the incorrect one. Chit funds are now banned from taking deposits from the public. Punishment ranges from 1 year to 10 years. Fraudulent default in regulated deposit schemes will also come under UDS, which is unregulated, banning of unregulated deposit schemes. Advertising or promoting an unregulated deposit scheme is also to be considered an offense. So what are the offenses? There are three offenses. Number one, fraudulent default in regulated deposit schemes. Number two, as mentioned here, advertising or promoting an unregulated deposit scheme. And third one is running an unregulated deposit scheme. So all these three are considered as offenses under this ordinance. Therefore, both these are certainly right options. Chit funds are now banned. Chit funds, if you apply some logic, you will find out that chit funds are actually regulated under Chit Funds Act 1987, which comes under state governments. So all the state governments are required to regulate chit funds. Therefore, chit funds not being an unregulated deposit activity, it cannot be banned under Unregulated Deposit Schemes Act. So this one is incorrect. Punishment ranges from 1 year to 10 years. This is a factual option and certainly correct. Therefore, 2, 3 and 4 are correct and only 1 is incorrect. So the answer is E, 1 is incorrect. Let's come to the next question. Consider the following statements regarding Democracy Index 2018 and identify the incorrect one. We have to find out the incorrect one. The index classifies countries into 4 types: full democracies, flawed democracies, hybrid democracies, and authoritarian regimes. Please tell me, where does India lie? If you have read about this, where does India lie among these 4 classifications? Is it a full democracy? Is it a flawed democracy? Is it a hybrid democracy? Or is it an authoritarian regime? The index is based on 5 parameters. I have created an acronym so that it's easier for you to remember these 5 parameters, and I'll be discussing that very shortly, and it's very interesting and very easy to remember as well. India has been classified as a flawed democracy. Is it correct or incorrect? Pakistan has been classified as an authoritarian regime, correct or incorrect? A total of 189 countries are ranked under Democracy Index 2018. Well, India's rank in Democracy Index 2018 is 41 out of a total of 167 countries which were analyzed. So D, fifth option is incorrect. Pakistan is, yes, an authoritarian regime as per the Democracy Index. India is a flawed democracy, yes, as per the Democracy Index. And yes, there are four classifications on under this indices, that is full democracy, flawed, hybrid and authoritarian. And yes, it is based on five parameters, which I will be discussing very shortly. So the answer is 1, 2, 3, 4 are correct, and only the fifth one is incorrect. So the answer to this question is D. What are these five parameters? How to learn them? The acronym to learn them is very simple. Process and culture of liberty by the government can increase participation. Process and culture of liberty by the government can increase participation. I hope you have mugged up this particular acronym. It's very easy to remember. Process and culture of liberty by the government can increase participation. What is process? This is the parliamentary process. Okay. What is the culture? This is the political culture in the country. What is liberty? It is civil liberties, this level of civil liberties which are provided to the people. What is government? Functioning of the government. What kind of functioning does the government involve itself into? What is participation? Political participation. What kind of participation is provided or is enjoyed by the people in the country when it comes to politics of the country? So these are the five parameters, and I hope you will be able to remember them. I'm coming out with these kinds of acronyms in order to make it easy for you to learn it. So instead of writing those five parameters, you can just write this acronym and try and remember it. It's very easy to remember these kind of things, which will make your studies easier because you have a lot of facts, a lot of information, a lot of knowledge to accumulate and keep in your mind. Therefore, these kind of acronyms, which are interesting, which can be easily learned, which you can relate with, are important for the examination. Let's come to the last question for today. MFN status. What is the full form of MFN? Please provide it to me in the comment section below so that I know whether you have read a little about in the ESI section or not. MFN status provides which of the following to a nation? Number one, it helps member countries of WTO. It helps member countries of WTO to provide special treatment to its other members. So the keyword here is special treatment. It helps all member countries of WTO to treat every other nation equally without any discrimination. It helps WTO members in creating a trade union through special status to other members. And the fourth one is it helps WTO members in creating a customs union through special status to other members. Yes, special status, that is the most favored nation status, is provided. But does it want to create a trade union or a customs union? No, it does not. Most favored nation status is not a voluntary but a mandatory status which is to be provided by every member of WTO to every other member. And the purpose of MFN status is not to provide any special treatment, or not to say that you are most favored nation for us, because it's provided to every other nation which is a part of WTO. It is the name itself does not provide us clarity on what is the purpose of MFN. But the purpose of MFN is to treat every other nation equally without any discrimination. It means that every other nation which is a member of WTO is a most favored nation, which cannot be true because it says most favored, but in fact that is the real meaning or real purpose of providing MFN status. So it does not provide any special treatment. It only treats every other nation equally and therefore does not allow discrimination between nation members of WTO by a nation which is providing MFN status to the other nation. So let's say India provides MFN status to all the other members, which includes Bangladesh, which includes Sri Lanka, Bhutan, Nepal, Myanmar, Thailand, so on and so forth. That means it cannot say that with Bangladesh we are going to have only 10% tariffs, but with Nepal we are going to have 20% or 30% tariffs on textiles. Or with Vietnam, we are going to have 50% tariffs when it comes to textiles. That cannot be the case if all these members have been provided with MFN status under World Trade Organization rules by India. I hope this lesson helped you. These are all the questions that I discussed today. All the very best. Take care.